So, I do not have to harp on where condensers are used, okay, in two phase flow heat exchangers, condensers are a norm. So, I will straight get into Nusselt condensation. Why is it called Nusselt condensation, we know, but before we go to Nusselt condensation, there are two types of condensation. One is film wise, another one is drop wise. So, in the film wise condensation, it is very natural to imagine in a film wise condensation there is a film, and in drop wise condensation the condensation is occurring in the form of drops. To just give you the visual picture, this is the film, a liquid film is being formed here, drop wise condensation. So, out of the two, which one is the best one? Drop wise condensation. But maintaining drop wise condensation thoroughly is always difficult. So, you usually, what to say, paint or treat, you treat the surface with an appropriate material or a paint such that you can maintain drop wise condensation, but then this treatment would not last for eternity. It is going to last only for short time, short duration. Short means it can be few days, few months. Okay. So, after that again it is going to get back to film condensation. So, that is the reason why we always study only film wise condensation, and not only we study, all heat exchangers are built on the base, or the condensers are designed on the basis of film wise condensation. Even if you do drop wise, even if you heat treat it, even if you treat the wall with paints, what are the paints? I think I have some material here which says stearic acid. If you apply it with stearic acid, so there is it should not get wetted. Basically, it should not get wetted, then only wetted means the fluid should not go and stick to it. That kind of treatment I should make it, but then the treatment cannot last for long. So, whenever I design a condenser, I am going to design it on the basis of film wise condensation, not on drop wise condensation, even if I would have treated my surface. Even if I would have treated my surface, I would continue to design it on the basis of film wise condensation. Okay. So, with that understanding, so I do not want to lose time. This is the film, there is a small film being formed, we are going to spend enough time on that. And naturally, why do we go for condensers? Because in two phase flows, the heat transfer coefficients are very, very high. How high? Yes. How high? They can be as these drop wise condensation can have a heat transfer coefficient of 30,000 watts per meter square Kelvin. On the other hand, film wise condensation is typically of the order of 11,700. These are just numbers. Just to say that drop wise condensation roughly is 2 to 3 times better than that of film wise condensation. Okay. So, with that background, let us get into what is called as Nusselt condensation. It is called as Nusselt condensation because Nusselt was the person who derived it for the first time. Okay. So, let me just go ahead, if I take a flat plate, I am just taking a vertical plate. To give you the big picture of today, the condensation, I take a plate, and condensation can be, as I showed in the previous picture, initially it is will be laminar and then it is wavy. My boundary layer is going to start from the top, okay, because it has to condense and fall. It is quite different, converse to natural convection. Okay, but the same body force is going to come. Okay. So then it is called here wavy, but we can as well call it as transition, there is no harm, and it can subsequently go to turbulent. But I am going to focus only till here. I am not going to focus anything above that. Okay. And of course, correlations can be given in the same lines what we have derived for laminar to turbulent also. Now, coming back, so what is this? This is my boundary layer thickness, or not boundary layer, I should not be calling here boundary layer, because it is a liquid film. film it has got condensed. Why should it condense? Why is film being formed on the vertical plate? Because my plate is now maintained at a lower temperature. Lower temperature. How lower? Below saturation temperature corresponding to the pressure in which it is operating. Here let us say we can say it is atmosphere. Is that okay? So, if I can bring down my wall temperature lower than the saturation temperature of the liquid, then I am going to get the condensation on my plate. Okay. Now, having understood that, so coordinates, let us get the coordinates fixed. So, I have x, I have y, okay. This is my x, this is my y, and of course, this is my u and this is my v. Without losing time, we will be coming to this little later, do not worry about that. So, there is a velocity and there is a temperature gradient. Okay. So, how do I start? How do I start with so many cases done so far? How do I start? I have to start momentum and energy equations. So, in the assumptions, I am taking that laminar flow, constant properties are assumed, gas is assumed to be pure vapor at a uniform temperature equal to saturation temperature. Okay. So, we will, there is no, it's a pure vapor, there is no mixture. And shear stress, I will emphasize this at the end, there is no shear stress at the liquid vapor interface. That is, I am considering that the vapor outside is not moving at all, it is still. If there is a vapor moving, there is a vapor no around, if the vapor is moving around that, what will happen? There is interfacial shear stress. There is a shear stress, because one film is moving at one velocity and the vapor is moving at the another velocity. So, you are supposed to expect a interfacial shear stress. Interface means it is the interface between the liquid film and the vapor. Okay. Interface, inter, word inter means in between, intermission, we use the word intermission, in between phase, in between the two phases, that is between the phase of liquid and the vapor phase. Vapor phase I am taking it as 0, that is why there is no interfacial shear stress at the interface. Only liquid is moving, but the vapor is not moving. I am saying, when I say interface, I mean here along this interface. Vapor were to move, let us say, in fact there will be a slight movement of the vapor in real life, but if the vapor is moving, then there will be a slip, no, then there will be slip. If there is a slip, then again I am going to have the, professor told us, it is not about stationary flat plate and flow moving on it. As long as I have the relative velocity, I am going to have the slip and I am going to have the shear stress. So, that is what it is. It has to be less than, no? How will it condense otherwise? Yeah, correct, correct, okay. Condensation starts, but then will the heat transfer start between the plate and, when will the heat transfer start between the plate and the my film? When there is a temperature gradient. So, that temperature gradient has to be established by keeping the wall temperature lower. Okay, fine. Okay. So, now the next recourse is I will have to take up my same momentum and continuity equation. And I am sure now, by now you would have felt already that one of the momentum equations will definitely vanish. Which one it would be? X momentum equation, because your velocity is more in the y direction. So, this equation is not important, although I have gone at length and tried to show here, all that is not required now. dP, this is del p by del y can be replaced as dP by dy. You see here, this is rho L, here rho L into g, and this dP by dy has to be replaced by dP by dy is the imposed pressure from the inviscid portion, that is the outside the film here. Is that right? Then that is nothing but again here hydrostatic pressure. Hydrostatic pressure dP infinity by dy, which is equal to rho V into g. If I substitute that, I will get rho L u del V by del x plus V del V by del y equal to mu L plus del squared y by del x squared. Why del squared v by del y squared has been thrown out? There are two terms now in my momentum equation, del squared v by del x squared plus del squared V by del y squared. I have thrown out del squared V by del y squared. My film thickness is of the order of delta, y is of the order of my plate height, delta is substantially lower compared to that of my plate height. So, that is why I can throw del squared V by del y squared. I think now we can feel it without even thinking, is not it. So, G into, now actually all this presentation of condensation is beautifully given by Professor Bejan. I would suggest that please read, no other book gives the way Bejan gives. Okay. I am a standard, I am a great fan of Bejan, but that does not matter. The way I have understood condensation by reading Bejan, I have not understood that way by reading Incorpora and DeWitt or Chengal or any other book for the, even two phase flow books for that matter. When I read Nusselt condensation in Bejan, because he does that through scale analysis, I will tell you in a couple of minutes what are we going to do. So, please before teaching or before our end workshop, main workshop, please read Bejan's portion. Problem with Bejan is that Bejan's book is quite expensive, 9000 rupees it costs heat transfer by Bejan, but convective heat transfer is cheap. I just brought, this is expensive, 9000, maybe Indian edition has come, I am not aware, but convective heat transfer, this is the Indian edition, I mean what is that, not Indian edition, student edition restricted for Asia. So, this is this is 420 rupees. So, you can read this, same thing is there, but in an elaborated version, whatever you start here in this, that much portion you read in this book. Okay. So, this is quite cheap. I would strongly recommend each one, every teacher should have this book, because scale analysis you can understand through this book. Okay. Okay. So, now coming back, what is the each term? What is the each term? The first term on the left hand side is, first two terms are the inertia. First term on the right hand side is friction, viscous, it is friction. And what about this? G into rho L minus rho V. Here Bejan calls it as, instead of buoyancy force, because it is not buoyancy, because it is liquid which is falling, it is actually opposite to buoyancy, that is sinking. It is coming down, sinking, that is what Bejan calls. I think it is okay. Sinking is a good opposite for buoyancy. Now what does he do to get a closed form solution? To get a closed form solution, he neglects inertia. It is quite difficult to understand. He neglects inertia. See, inertia has to be balanced by frictional force and sinking effect. Is that right? Inertia has to be balanced by friction and sinking effect. But what is his contention is that sinking effect is, what is happening? Physically, let us think. What is happening? Condensation has happened because of we are maintaining low temperature, it starts falling. There is a sinking effect, but because of the sinking is happening, there is resistance for the film to drop or the velocity for the fluid to drop, but it is having momentum also. But that momentum, who has created? Temperature gradient. But what he is saying is that sinking effect predominates over the inertia. For a minute, it is quite difficult to explain by doing order of magnitude analysis or say that, okay, this is larger than this, so this is smaller, so I can neglect. It is quite difficult to do. So, you can even say that I will assume, I am going to assume. How will I check whether my assumption is right or wrong at the end? Whatever heat transfer coefficient I am going to compute using this assumption, if I check that with my experimental data, that will tell me or suggest me whether this assumption is valid or not. But otherwise, it is quite difficult to explain why this inertia is substantially lower compared to that of sinking effort. Why are we going to throw this inertia out? It is a mathematical expediency, means if I throw this inertia out, I can get the closed form simple solution. Okay, that is what Nusselt did, that is the greatness of Nusselt. Okay. So, come on, if I throw this, my equation looks simple. So, mu del squared V by del x squared plus g into rho L minus rho V equal to 0. What are the boundary conditions? At x equal to 0, V is 0, and at x equal to delta, what is this? Del V by del x equal to 0? Interfacial shear stress is 0. Okay. So, now if I integrate this, I get mu L del V by del x plus g rho L minus rho V into x equal to c 1. Further integration, I will get mu L V plus x squared by 2 c 1 x plus c 2. If I apply first boundary condition, c 2 is 0. If I apply second boundary condition, I am going to get V equal to g into rho L minus rho V. So, now you get the velocity. Did I get the velocity here? Do I know everything on the right hand side? Of the velocity? Boundary layer, not boundary layer thickness, film thickness is not known. Until I know the film thickness, I do not know the velocity. Let me keep that, I have to figure out the film thickness. How? Okay, I will come to that little later. Only thing I will just try to do here is mass flow rate. Your mass flow rate no one is going to give us. The mass flow rate is being generated because of the temperature gradient. So what do I get? Mass flow rate. Here Bejan uses tau, so I am also using tau. Tau of y equal to rho L V dx 0 to delta. That is per unit width I am taking. Perpendicular to board, the plate width I am taking as 1. So, rho L V into dx integrated over 0 to delta. If I integrate that, I am going to end up with g rho L rho L minus rho V into delta cube by 3 mu L. If I have to get total mass flow rate, I will have to multiply this gamma y into B. So, that is what I have done, and this is the mass flow rate, but I cannot be very happy because still my unknown is delta. Delta is not known. So, all that it is saying is that flow rate is proportional to sinking effect. Natural, if the density gradient is high, if rho L minus rho V is large, my mass flow rate has to very easy to physically feel, and viscosity is sitting in the denominator. If viscosity rises, my mass flow rate has to slow down. I think this is very obvious from our forced convection. So, this is the physical field. Now, how do I get? Next question is to get the delta. So, what am I going to do within my delta is that I am going to assume that it is going to be purely conduction, because I have thrown, is it logical or not? Why? Because I have thrown all my inertia terms. So, it is conduction, pure conduction. Conduction in which direction? X direction. So, if it is 1D conduction, means what should be the governing equation? D squared T by dx squared, get back to my heat diffusion equation. Del squared T by del y squared, del squared T by del z squared, transient term, all that are going to vanish. I am going to end up with del squared T by del x squared equal to 0. If I integrate this, I am going to get a linear equation. That is del T by del x equal to c 1 and x equal to 0, T equal to T wall, c T equal to. So, what are the boundary conditions? At x equal to delta, T equal to T sat. And at x equal to 0, T equal to T 1. So, if I put those boundary conditions, I am going to get T equal to T sat minus T wall into x by delta plus T 1. So, this is a linear temperature profile. We all know if I assume conduction, that is what I am supposed to get between T wall and the T sat. Okay. Now, this is again standard. I do not have to, what is my H definition? H equal to K L into del T by del x at the wall, that is at x equal to 0, upon T sat minus T wall. Remember, one new thing I have introduced for q double dash, this we know, q double dash equal to k L del T by del x at wall, but what is the definition here I am using? H into, earlier for q double dash was equal to H into T wall minus T infinity or T infinity minus T wall. Here I am taking T sat minus T wall. Please note that difference. T sat minus T wall. If I substitute that, here temperature gradient is going to be K L into T sat minus T wall within, it is a linear temperature profile. So, I can write this T sat minus T wall upon delta. So, T sat minus T sat minus T wall get cancelled out, K L by delta, still I have not got delta. I have put mass flow rate in terms of delta, heat transfer coefficient in terms of delta. Now, our pursuit is to get delta. Let us see whether how do we get that. So, next is, okay, you will have to follow my steps. So, that is mass flow rate equal to, this is what we had derived. So, if I try to find dm dot by dy, how does this mass flow rate vary with y, that is the vertical ordinate. So, you get 3 delta square d delta by dx, is that right? Is that right? Rate of condensation of vapor, rate of condensation of vapor over the vertical distance. Is it understood or not? Why? Okay, let us spend time, this is something critical. So, why am I writing 3 delta square into d delta by dx? Rate of condensation of vapor over a distance, y, or is it mistake? It is a mistake. It is d delta by, because I am differentiating with respect to y, it has to be d delta by dy. It is d delta by dy. Okay. So, then in the next, what is this, where is this heat transfer going? Where is this heat transfer going? We are forgetting latent heat. So, dq dot, whatever heat transfer is taking place within the film, it has to be balanced through rate of heat transfer from the vapor to the plate through liquid film has to be equal to the heat released as the vapor as it is getting condensed. So, that is what I have done, dq dot equal to dm dot hfg, dm dot by dm dot hfg is equal to dm dot equal to dq dot is also equal to dm dot hfg is the latent heat, that is this, but this is also equal to what is this? What is this? Conduction. K L into B del dy into T sat minus T wall upon delta. So, if I compare this equation with this equation, I am going to get, if I compare A and B, unfortunately they are in two different locations, I am going to get one huge equation. If I solve this with respect to, this is y, it is y, again copy paste problem, y. So, if I integrate that, I am going to get this equation, okay. But delta is equal to 0 at y equal to, what is delta at y equal to 0? Y has started at the tip of my plate, 0, film is 0. So, C is equal to 0, I am going to get delta as a function of y. If delta has got, I have obtained delta, means I have got now both mass flow rate and also the heat transfer coefficient, velocity of course, the heat transfer coefficient. That is what I have done in the following steps, which I am not going to follow. Because delta is there, I have told that heat transfer coefficient is equal to K by delta. Delta we have just now found, I will substitute for that delta. If I have to get the average, I will integrate. Professor Arun has taught us 1 by L 0 to L hy dy, I am going to get the heat transfer coefficient. Still, I have not answered the question whether that assumption was right or wrong. So, people have found that, even in spite of that assumption, people have found that this equation, whatever heat transfer coefficient I compute using this equation and the experimentally measured heat transfer coefficients match. So, that is why that assumption is a I will come to that, I have not yet come to that yet. See, another thing, what is that agreed till that point, is that agreed? So, now people, after this people go on modifying various things. I have now assumed saturation temperature, but what if there is subcooling, what if there is subcooling, okay? If there is subcooling, so they just Rosenhove takes that HFG, instead of taking HFG here, he suggests HFG prime, which is equal to HFG plus 0.68 into CPL T sat minus T wall. What is this? This is latent heat, this is sensible heat and this is latent. He came up with a number called Jacob number, which is sensible heat upon latent heat, and that ratio you see here, this he suggested this 0.68, okay. And when I take this and I take the properties at T sat plus T wall by 2, so this in all that he said is if there is subcooling, replace HFG in the previous equation with HFG prime, okay. So that is where HFG prime. So this is the Jacob number definition, and this is what he suggested. HFG prime is going to be basically the heat released is going to have both the latent heat and also the sensible heat. So that, yeah, one second. So then now the question is, people do this, represent this data in terms of Reynolds number, because we have this always inclination to go back to Reynolds number. But do we know Reynolds number here, like natural convection? Do we know natural convection Reynolds number? No. So here also we do not know Reynolds number, but we have computed mass flow rate now. Have we computed mass flow rate? We had shown that gamma y equal to g rho l blah 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 into delta q. Delta we have computed. Delta we have computed here. So if I plug in that delta, I am supposed to get my mass flow rate. And that mass flow rate is, if I substitute that delta q, if I substitute delta, I do not substitute anything. That huge equation people usually do not substitute. People try to put that in terms of heat transfer coefficient. What is delta? K by H. So that is what, because we just showed, no, H equal to K by delta. So same thing I have rewritten, and K delta at x equal to L is K L upon H at x equal to L. So if I substitute that, I get Reynolds number as 4G, okay, here 4G delta cube, same thing. If I substitute that, and I substitute this local H turns out to be 3 by 4 times the H average. So if I substitute that, I get H average in terms of Reynolds number, in terms of Reynolds number. Now just to show that, here I have taken hydraulic diameter as 4 delta. All the time you will see that, you will see that I have taken 4 delta here, hydraulic diameter I have taken it as 4 delta. That is true. I have just put this figure, I have just copy pasted from Chengal. I just to, you can go through this, because this is just area upon perimeter. It turns out that for any configuration, it turns out that it is equal to 4 delta. Is that okay? So now with this, so I guess what is, let us summarize what is that we have studied so far. What did we do? We took a vertical plate, and we kept that vertical plate temperature below that of the saturation temperature. So then what is happening? The condensation is happening on my plate. Now we are interested in the film thickness. We are interested in the film thickness. We wrote the momentum equation and the energy equation. Which momentum equation we threw out? X momentum equation. In the Y momentum equation, we ended up with inertia force, viscous force, and the sinking force or sinking effect. And we went ahead and made a very bold assumption that inertia effects are very less. So we threw that out. So it so happened that now it becomes, viscous force becomes equal to sinking effect. Using that, we could get a relation for delta. No, we could get, what is that we got using that? We got the velocity, but in terms of delta. And we went ahead and made the assumption, because we have thrown the inertial terms, we went ahead and assumed that inertia term in my, convection term in my energy equations are also neglected. So I end up with conduction equation. Conduction, I am assuming that again it is only 1D conduction. If I do that conduction, it turns out that H is equal to K by delta. Again my unknown is delta. So for getting delta, what is that I invoked? I balanced the equation, whatever heat transferred by conduction is equal to latent heat. Without that information, I would not have got delta. That is very key, okay. I think it is always a good thing to summarize in terms of algorithm after your derivation is over, the way we did it. I am going fast, but on the board, what did we do? We took this equation, threw this out, just to put sort of algorithm. It gives the big picture, because here I did not stop anywhere in between and asked what are we doing, why are we doing, because I was fast. Okay. So, I got the delta, then I got the velocity distribution, I got the heat transfer coefficient, I got the mass flow. The same thing now can be extended to other configuration. You can do the same thing for cylinder. Same analysis you can do, there is no harm. Only thing is that little bit that constant will change. You can give that as exercise for students. Okay. And for turbulent, again there are correlations. You cannot derive for turbulent, there are correlations. Before end workshop, I will put those correlations. Okay. I have seen that they are there in Changal, I have seen that, but whatever be the configuration, whatever be the configuration, I want to make one statement that whatever be the configuration, my heat transfer coefficient ultimately is going to look in this form only. All that it is going to change is, okay, this is for vertical. Now for wavy portion also there is a correlation given. Okay. How do you decide whether I am in laminar or wavy is based on Reynolds number. Here for all Reynolds numbers less than 30, it is laminar. For all Reynolds numbers less than 30, it is going to be laminar. So, how do I know that? It is coming through experiments. Okay. So, there is a correlation given for wavy laminar, and for turbulent this is the correlation. Okay. So, these are all obtained by experiments. Of course, there are some theories also one can work out for at least for vertical plates, but for complicated configurations it becomes quite difficult. So, that is about the, I would stop here for condensation, but I have just filled in because based on your request whatever I had, I have just adjusted that, so that at least the crux of the matter I can drive home. We can build upon the skeleton before the main workshop. Now open for questions. Yes ma'am, what is your question?
Term, sir. But when you neglect the inertial, when you have a heat exchanger, actual heat exchanger in which flow is taking place, the particular value of Reynolds number, isn't it, sir? Reynolds number, then it means that inertial term, how will you neglect? You have some 1800 or so Reynolds number you show for lamina.
We are mixing up things. That is right. It is like asking a question. Why I am rephrasing this question, because I got your question. It is like asking, I am going to design a heat exchanger, but you are suggesting me a heat transfer coefficient for natural convection, but in my heat exchanger there is going to be a forced flow. How can I apply the heat transfer coefficient which has been derived for natural convection for forced convection? Can I use this for heat exchanger in which flow is taking place? Can I use this for that? No, absolutely no. There is no flow here. It is like natural convection. It is like natural convection. That is, condensation in tubes is a different ball game with forced flow. There are correlations actually. In fact, there is a beautiful correlation called Shah's correlation. It so turns out that Nusselt number upon nu Dittus Boelter. I take this example again because Dittus Boelter is the mother everywhere. Nu condensation upon nu Dittus Boelter is equal to function of quality, thermodynamic quality. It turns out like that. It's Shah's correlation, it works beautifully well. That is the correlation I am supposed to use, and how it has been obtained? It has come out through experiments. So, for various, because when it is condensing, my quality is going to increase. So, as it increases, I am going to fix the length. So, please do not get confused. It is like to make myself understand, I am not trying to use natural convective heat transfer coefficient correlation to forced convection. Okay. Yes, sir. Zero shear stress, because I know that there is vapor moving. To make my life easy, I am taking the interfacial shear stress as 0, but I do not think it is a very invalid assumption. because interfacial vapor is not really going to move at a very high velocity, okay. Vapor is having velocity means all this will fall. That is what, if there is a flow taking place, then it gets into forced flow. This is like, as I keep saying, I always imagine like natural convection and forced convection. Here my my air which is there outside is still. That is it. Yeah. See, you please imagine natural convection and forced convection. That is where ma'am also got confused. So, it is natural convection. It is like natural convection. Only thing is that I have a film form. Is that okay? Any more questions? Sir, I can spend 5 more minutes. Yeah.
Regarding the same topic, sir.
Okay.
By wall shear stress, we mean that either you can.
Shear stress means what? Let us get back to basic question. What is shear stress? Velocity gradients. So far, we usually get tuned in our minds because shear stress can occur because my plate is.
Also, sir, if your fluid is stationary, the plate is moving, then also you have a similar condition here, isn't it, sir?
Where?
Your vapor is stationary, your film is
moving. That is what I am saying. That is why I am neglecting that interfacial shear stress. That shear stress only I am neglecting. And actually, that vapor is not going to be still in real life, it is going to be slight velocity is going to be there. Okay, let us go ahead and assume that vapor is still, that shear stress only I am taking it as 0. I am taking it as 0, otherwise I cannot get the closed form solution. How, in which other way I can answer you why I can take this shear stress as 0, I cannot get it any other way. Because that is right. No, that is right. That is shear stress only. That is why I am saying it. Why I am saying, what is that written there? 0 shear. What is that it is written there? 0 shear. Del u by del y is equal to 0. So we are assuming that, assuming this is an assumption again. But that is a good question. Maybe I will think back. I have not thought much because this just came out of the blue after, maybe I have taught this, maybe after 4 or 5 years I am teaching this, but that is fine. We will keep this in the back of the mind, but this I can go ahead and say that this is an assumption because it works. That way I can get away, but still that is not a convincing answer. We will see how best we can answer it further later on. Is that okay? Any more questions?